Okay, are we ready to go? Yes. There's Grandma. You know, it's a whole space center inside. Inside space center. So this one is going up and down, making a move. So I don't know how they feel inside. I hope they're not getting too dizzy. I know. I see your teeth.
Hey,
Jeff.
Approaching Rocket Park. We'll take a closer look at the rockets on the way back. For now, take yourself back to the year 1967. The Monkees' I'm a Believer was a number one single, but the political climate was not so upbeat. 500,000 American soldiers were stationed in Vietnam, and tensions of the Cold War were running high. The space program was under immense pressure to get a man to the moon before the end of the decade. On January 27, 1967, tragedy struck the Apollo program. Flight Director Gene Kranz remembers that day.
We were in mission control, testing the Apollo Commander service rocket. The test that day had for granted because S-18 failure in mission control is inevitable.
Investigations after the fire led to major design and engineering changes, enhancing the safety of the capsule. Here at JSC, remember our fallen heroes by continuing to reach for the stars. Up ahead and to your right is Building 17. 32 behind them is the Space Environment Simulation Laboratory. The nitrogen is used to simulate the cold, harsh atmosphere of space to test the tolerance of spacecraft. Astronaut Robert Kirby of space in firsthand. He's logged over 901 hours in space, including 7 spacewalks.
Third spacewalk, we were able to see the shadow on top of the top of the space station. It was in the back end of the cargo bay of the space shuttle. And it was absolutely freezing. The coldest I've ever been. It's the only time I've ever been in the world.
Astronaut Mike Folsom has logged over 21 hours on EVAs or extravehicular activities.
Kind of peer out and you can see the clouds and the Earth rolling by 200 some miles below. When you slide out of the airlock hatch for the first time, it's a feeling I'll never forget. Kind of hanging on to the handrails right by the hatch.
The floor down below us is where astronauts learn how to live and work in space.
But this area of Building 9 has the space station mock-ups.
Astronaut Mike Fossum points out a few of the training units you can see here.
These are actual training units that we use a lot for crew training. The engineers use these to go in and make sure that new equipment's going to fit when we fly it up to the space station itself. This is actually a working laboratory that you're looking at here. The pieces of the space station are spread about on the floor. Most of them are roughly in the configuration that we have in space, but because we're limited to the flat floor, there's some things that are laid out a little bit differently here, but it gives you an idea for the sheer magnitude of all of these elements of the space station. One of the big ones right in front of you is the U.S. laboratory, and inside that are most of the equipment and the racks, just like we have it in space. We use these for training different types of space station procedures. We go in and practice the logistics of what it takes to move things from one end to the other. A little bit over to your left is the space station airlock. I've personally spent hundreds of hours in there as we
too heavy, you cannot carry it. I could do it. Yeah.
Because they are not needed for training purposes, and because they simply wouldn't fit inside the building if they had them. Now, lying across this cargo bay, you will see a large white pole. This is known as the Remote Manipulator System, or RMS. And since this pole is also made and manufactured in Canada, it is known as the Canada Arm. Now, while in space, this arm is capable of lifting and moving objects weighing thousands of pounds. However, once it's brought back to Earth, it can't lift its own weight due to Earth's gravity. So to help train our astronauts, we have constructed a larger, stronger working model that we will see in just a moment. Now, to the right behind the FFT are two nose portions of the shuttle orbiter, helping out our astronauts and doing various repairs up there. So at this time, if you would, please follow me down to a third final stop here. All right, ladies and gentlemen, now we have one more short audio presentation. So if you would, please lower your voices so everyone can hear. Thanks.
Directly in front of us is an area where the astronauts practice using the highly articulated robotic arms used to manipulate objects in space. It is equipped with a shoulder with a yaw, pitch, and roll, an elbow with a single degree of movement, and a wrist with a yaw, pitch, and roll as well.
The Building 9 station robotic manipulator simulates how we do operations on board the International Space Station, and in order to do that on Earth with the gravity that we have here, we have to use either things like balloons filled with helium, or we use very lightweight equipment that this arm can push, and we usually use wheels or ways to slide it across the floor. So we can move the objects that are the same size that they'll be in outer space, we just can't move them in the same fashion, so we kind of have to trick the simulator to make it look like we do when we do it in space. I have spent numerous hours in training.
We dance. Bless you. Is that you, Nick?
Yeah.
You sneeze? You go in, the allergy win. Hey, Max, come on. che bella cellula, all the rocket. The pipe, the pipe, the pipe inside. Not sure what they have inside. Huh? You don't want?
No, cool, no good.
Max,
you have to get back on the tram to go back.
No, this is a bay, not the ocean. I think it's a bay, but it's a massive bay. Oh, it's a bay.
Oh, they do?
Just like,
because it's
free.
Because you have the... Jackie.
Thank you.
This is it for today, we're going home, huh?